Welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Upneet Lali, and today I will be discussing the module on bail, remission, parole, and premature release. The learning objectives are, firstly, to understand the meaning of bail and various provisions under the law for the grant of bail. Second is to understand the concept of premature release and distinguish between various types of premature release. Third is to be able to differentiate between remissions granted by the state and the prison authorities. Fourth is to be able to distinguish between parole and furlough. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights enshrines under Article 9 that no one shall be subjected to arbitrary arrest, detention or exile. As India is a signatory to the UN Declaration of Human Rights of 1948, the concept of bail has found a place within the scope of human rights. While no right of freedom is absolute in any country, there are limitations provided under the law. A person can be taken into custody by arresting him based on suspicion of having committed a crime. Article 21 of the Indian Constitution guarantees the right to life and personal liberty as a fundamental right. It states, "No one shall be denied his right to life and personal liberty except by a procedure established by law." And the Supreme Court in the Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India case held that the procedure of this right has to be just, fair and reasonable. Now, bail remains undefined in the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973, the CRPC, and nowhere else has this term been statutorily defined conceptually. The meaning of bail etymologically is derived from an old French verb bailer, which means to give or to deliver. Bail is a conditional liberty. According to Black's Law Dictionary, what is contemplated by bail is to procure the release of a person from legal custody by undertaking that he or she shall appear at the time and place designated and submit herself or himself to the jurisdiction and judgment of the court. The CRPC of 1973 does not define bail, although the terms bailable offence and non-bailable offence have been defined in Section 2A of the CRPC as follows. Bailable offence means an offence which is shown as bailable in the first schedule and which is made bailable by any other law for the time being in force. And non-bailable offence means any other offence. Hence, it can be generally stated that all serious offences, that is offences for which punishment is imprisonment for 3 years or more, have been considered as non-bailable offences. And Section 436 to 450 of the CRPC provide for provisions for grant of bail and bail bonds and for security to be paid by the accused to secure his release. The amount has not been specifically mentioned in the CRPC. So it is at the discretion of court to put a monetary cap on the bail bonds. The Code of Criminal Procedure confers wide powers upon the police of making arrest. And in addition to the power of arrest, the code bestows upon police the powers which are parallel to the magistrate to release any arrested person on bail. However, the Indian courts have been granted greater discretion to grant bail, to deny bail in the case of persons who have been arrested under a criminal law, and it is usually refused when the accused is charged with homicide. The CRPC provides that a person who is suspected of having committed a cognizable offence can be remanded into police custody. Many times you would have seen that persons who are remanded into police custody, they have been taken for interrogation. However, any person who is arrested by a police officer has to be produced, should be produced before a judicial magistrate within 24 hours from the time of his arrest. Further, Section 41, Subclause 1 provides that the police officer shall, in all cases where the arrest of a person is not required, issue a notice of appearance. The police and magistrate have been given the power to grant bail under the CRPC. However, in case of bailable offences, bail can be claimed as a matter of right. The police or the magistrate has no discretion in this regard, and if a person commits any non-bailable offence, then it is on the discretion of the magistrate that whether the bail should be granted or denied. Section 436 of the CRPC provides for release of bail in case of bailable offences, and Section 50, Subclause 2 provides, makes it mandatory obligatory for a police officer who is arresting a person without a warrant to inform him of his right to be released on bail. In fact, all the guidelines which were there given by the Supreme Court in various decisions, they have now all been incorporated by amendment in the CRPC. And bail or jail? That is the question which has repeatedly come before the courts, wielding immense judicial discretion while exercising their bail jurisdiction. In India, bail or release on personal recognizance is available as a right in bailable offences, not punishable with death or life imprisonment. And only to women and children in non-bailable offences, punishment where it is with even death or imprisonment, they can be released on bail. In the Sanjay Chandra versus Central Bureau of Investigation, that's the 2G spectrum scam case of 2012, the Supreme Court has come up with held that the object of bail is neither punitive nor preventive. Deprivation of liberty must be considered a punishment unless it can be required to ensure that an accused person will stand his trial when called upon. Even after conviction, post-conviction and pending appeal, pre-appeal bail is there under section 382 of the CRPC. The bail that is to be given by a police officer who can release a person who is accused of an offence and who has taken him into custody may be divided under two heads. One is when the person is arrested without any warrant, and second is when the arrest has been made in pursuance of a warrant case. That's, you have the warrant case as such. And section 437 of the CRPC has provisions which empower two authorities to consider the question of bail. One is a court which includes a high court, and the second is a court of session. And an officer in charge of a police station who has arrested or detained a person without warrant, a person accused or suspected of the commission of a non-bailable offence, that's a serious offence. The Honourable High Supreme Court in the case of Gurcharan Singh versus State of Delhi Administration, this is AIR 1978 case, has laid down factors to be taken into consideration while granting bail. And these were reiterated by the Supreme Court in the state of UP through CBI versus Amar Mani Tripathi in the 2005 case, wherein it said that it is well settled that the matters to be considered in an application for bail are A. Whether there is any prima facie reasonable ground to believe that the accused had committed the offence. 2. Is the nature and gravity of charge. 3. Is severity of the punishment in the event of conviction. And 4. Is the danger of the accused absconding or fleeing if released on bail. 5. Is the character, behaviour, mien, position and standing of the accused. Likelihood of the offence being repeated is the 6th. And 7th is reasonable apprehension of the witnesses being tampered with, or danger to the course of justice being thwarted by grant of bail. Imprisonment of under trials, we have seen, who are not granted bail by the court, sometimes it can exceed vastly the period of imprisonment prescribed for the offences they were charged with. And the first such case which came up before the Supreme Court in a PIL was the Hussain Ara Khatun case versus State of Bihar in 1979. In order to, because we have almost 66% of our population in prisons consisting of under trials, a new provision in CRPC was added by a criminal law amendment known as 436A. It was introduced to solve the problem of under trials who were languishing in jails. And according to this section, a person who has undergone detention for a period extending up to half of the maximum period of imprisonment imposed for a particular offence, that person now shall be released on his or her personal bond with or without sureties. However, no prisoner can be detained for a period longer than the maximum period of imprisonment provided. Let us say for a case of theft, the person is to be imprisoned for 3 years. If the person has already spent 3 years, the under trial will not have to continue remaining in prison. However, 436A is not applicable to offenders who have been sentenced to death and in cases of crimes against women and children. Bail can also be cancelled. According to section 437, subclause 5 of the CRPC, the power to cancel bail has been given to the courts and not to a police officer. Secondly, only the court which granted the bail can cancel it. Now we come to the topic, to the issue of parole and premature release of prisoners. Now the primary objective underlying premature release is the reformation of offenders and their rehabilitation and integration into society, while at the same time ensuring the protection of society from the criminal activities. And these two aspects are closely interlinked. Incidental to the same is the conduct and behavior and performance of prisoners while in prison. These have a bearing on their rehabilitative potential and the possibility of their being released by virtue of remission earned by them or by an order granting them premature release. The most important considerations for premature release of prisoners is that they have become harmless and useful members of a civilized society. Premature release of prisoners can be of the following four types. First is by way of commutation of sentence of life convict and other convicts under section 433 of the CRPC by the state government. Second is by way of remitting term sentence of a prisoner under section 432 of the CRPC 1973 by the state government. And third is by the order of the head of the state passed exercising powers under Article 72 and Article 161 of the Constitution of India, as the case may be. These are the powers of the President and the Governor. And premature release under any special law enacted by the state providing for release on probation of good conduct prisoners after they have served a part of the sentence. Now, if we look at remission, the remission system's aims are the reformation of a prisoner. The scheme is intended to ensure that prison discipline and good conduct on the part of prisoners and also encourage learning and better work culture with the prospect of their early release from prison as an incentive. Remission is a concession which can be granted to prisoners by the head of the state, appropriate government, or by the head of the prison department or by the superintendent of the prison. The appropriate government, of course, reserves the right to debar, withdraw any prisoner or category of prisoners from the concession of remission. So it's not applicable to every prisoner. The remissions which are granted other than by the head of the state may be withdrawn or forfeited if the prisoner commits, let's say, a specified jail offence or conditions prescribed in the relevant order for remitting the sentence that are there. Now, remission can be of three types. First is remission under the provisions of the Prison Act 1894 or respective prison acts of the state and the rules made thereunder. This can be earned by all eligible prisoners if they fulfill the required conditions. Second is the remission of in sentence granted by the appropriate government under section 432 of the CRPC. And third is remission by the head of the state under Article 72 and 161 of the Constitution of India. The head of the state has all the powers to grant remission to any prisoner on his request as well as grant general remission to the specified category of prisoners on special occasions on recommendation of the Council of Ministers. Normally this is done during Republic Day and before Independence Day. No rules can, however, be laid down for the head of the state for exercising powers under Article 72 and 161 of the Constitution of India. That is, no rules can be laid down for the President or the Governor to exercise these remission powers. The rules that are covered in the prison manuals of the state and therefore apply only on remission to be granted by the prison authorities. These are covered under the subparagraph of the Prisons Act of 1894 of respective or the state acts as such. Now, what is the purpose of remission? Remission should be granted on the basis of an inmate's overall good behavior during his stay in the jail. The willingness to take work while in custody, cooperation and help with the prison administration and prison management, and the general response to various institutional activities. The prison authorities can give two types of remission. One is the ordinary remission and second is the special remission. Ordinary remission is granted by the prison authorities, by the superintendent of a prison or an officer who is nominated by him on his behalf. To give that, and the eligibility is that it is given to convicted prisoners who are eligible for ordinary remission, prisoners who have a substantive sentence of 2 months or more, so not less than 2 months, and prisoners who have been sentenced to simple imprisonment for 2 months or more and who volunteer to work. Prisoners who are employed on prison maintenance works, let's say who are working in the kitchen and who are working on Sundays and holidays or sweeping, cooking, etc. Irrespective of the length and nature of their sentence, whether it is simple imprisonment, whether it is rigorous imprisonment, they are all eligible for ordinary remission. Non-eligibility, you have certain types of prisoners who are not eligible for ordinary remission, and these are prisoners having substantive sentence of less than 2 months, prisoners who have been sentenced in default of payment of fine only, and in the case of prisoners who are convicted of an offence committed after they have been inside the prison, under whether it is assault or any section of the IPC, if they've misused the concession of parole also, if they've not reported back on time after being released on furlough, these are the prisoners who are not going to be eligible for grant of this remission. Prisoners debarred from remission as a punishment. Sometimes prisoners commit prison offences, let's say taken in a mobile phone. So they may be debarred from getting remission because they have committed a prison offence. Now the scale of ordinary remission for convicted prisoners, it is mentioned in each state manual, and normally it is 3 days per calendar month for good behaviour, for discipline and for participation in institutional activities. Second category is the special remission, and authority to grant special remission is by the head of the prison department on the recommendations of the superintendent of prisons, who will be competent to grant the special remission. And the criteria for grant of special remission are in case of meritorious work, which is rewarded by special remission in addition to the annual good conduct remission, so that it creates a healthy competition among prisoners, so that they are motivated to behave well. And special remission is granted to prisoners who are also eligible for ordinary remission. If they've saved the life of a government employee or a prison visitor or a prison inmate, prevented or assisting or prevention of escape of prisoners, assisting the prison staff in handling emergencies like if there's a fire, if there's a disaster, outbreak of a riot or a strike, and also in case of outstanding contribution to cultural activities or educational programs, or acquiring additional educational qualification as a diploma, or teaching other prisoners art and craft and special skills to fellow inmates, and especially good behavior in industry, in agriculture or any other skill development program or in vocational training. So there they can be given special remission. And the grant, the scale for special remission shall not exceed 30 days in a calendar year completed by the prisoner in a jail. It may be granted by the head of the prison department on the recommendation which is made by the superintendent of a prison to those who are eligible for ordinary remission as such. Third is, then we come to the remission by the head of the state. Remission by the head of the state under Article 161 of the Constitution, it has to be exercised on the aid and advice of the Cabinet of Ministers, and it shall be called remission by the head of the state. Remission by the head of the state is granted on special occasions of national importance or public rejoicing. Obviously, no rules can be prescribed for the head of the state for granting this type of remission. Eligible, who are eligible? The remission of the head of state can be awarded to such prisoners or such categories of prisoners as the head of the state may decide. There is also provision for having a remission committee, and some states have a remission committee for to look into the remissions to be granted by the jail authorities. The amount of remission, now the maximum limit of an ordinary and special remission which a prisoner can earn should not be more than 1/4 of the substantive sentence to be calculated from the date of his conviction. The remission granted by the head of the state shall be in addition to the ordinary and the special remission which the prisoner has earned. However, in no circumstances the maximum limit of all types of remissions earned by prisoner should not exceed 1/3 of the substantive sentence. That means the prisoner has to at least pass that 1/3 sentence. Life convicts, life sentence shall be taken as imprisonment for 20 years for the purpose of calculation of remission, as per the logic given in section 57 of the Indian Penal Code. And the grant of remission to a life convict shall not mean actual remission in his sentence. When his case comes up to be examined by the review board, premature release board, for the premature release, the remission to his credit will be one of the factors on the basis of which the review for his sentence will be considered. So it doesn't mean that the prisoner will be released outright. The remission can be removed, it can be revoked, and it can be done by the head of the department on the recommendations of the superintendent of the prison. May remove any prisoner for remission for a period of 6 months, debar him, or for committing any specified prison offence. And the superintendent of a prison may also remove a prisoner for remission for 3 months. The conditions for forfeiture of remission are also laid down in the manuals. It may be forfeited by the head of the prison department, again on the recommendation of the superintendent. If the prisoner is convicted of an offence committed after admission in prison, under various sections. Let's say the person has assaulted another prisoner or a prison officer, has violated any of the prison laws, then not entitled to remission. Another important aspect is parole and furlough. The United Standard Minimum Rules for Treatment of Prisoners of 1955 prescribe temporary release of prisoners on parole and furlough in order to minimize the ill effects of incarceration. A regular contact of prisoners with the outside world is essential. Therefore, temporary release of prisoners on parole and furlough is important in the scheme of correction and social reintegration and rehabilitation of prisoners. Parole and furlough to inmates are progressive measures of correctional services. The privilege of release on parole and furlough should, of course, be allowed to selective prisoners on the basis of well-defined norms of eligibility and propriety. The objectives of releasing a prisoner on parole and furlough are to enable the inmate to maintain continuity with his family life and deal with family and social matters, to save him from the ill effects of continuous long prison life. Third is to enable him to maintain and develop his self-confidence. Fourth is to enable him to develop constructive hope and active interest in life. If the person knows that he is not going to be released for 20 years, 30 years, the prisoner loses hope. So parole and furlough are mechanisms which help a prisoner maintain hope, also to help him remain in touch with the developments of the outside world. What is happening? What changes are there in the real world? To help him remain physiologically and psychologically healthy, and to enable the prisoner to overcome and recover from the stress and ill effects of incarceration. Also motivate him to maintain good prison discipline while being in prison. Parole means temporary release of a prisoner for a short period so that he may maintain social relations with his family and the community in order to fulfill his family and social obligations and responsibilities. It's an opportunity which is given to a prisoner to maintain regular contact with the outside world so that he remains in touch with all that is happening as such. The period that a prisoner spends on parole while outside the jail is not counted, is in no way a concession. So he has to spend that amount of time in continuation as such. So he has to spend extra time while he's been out on parole. Parole is of two types: emergency parole, which is under the police protection, which is to cater to the family obligations, to meet, let's say there's been a death in the family or a serious illness or a marriage of a close relative. And the regular parole, which is given to take care of the social obligations, family responsibilities of regular nature, as well as for psychological and other needs of the prisoner to maintain contact with the outside world, whether it's a house repair or admission of children, etc., or for harvesting of crops. So the regular parole, that is there. In some of the states, it's the jail superintendent who is authorized to release a prisoner on emergency parole, whereas the DM and the senior jail authorities are granted, authorized to grant emergency parole in some other states. And if the prisoner does not qualify for release on parole, if there is a death of a family, then he can seek court intervention. And the court can grant that emergency parole under police escort. The eligibility, the convicts who are entitled for emergency parole, for regular parole, for furlough, they are all subjected to an eligibility criteria and other conditions which are prescribed by the state government under any special or local law and instructions that are given by the state. The under trial prisoners are not eligible for regular parole and furlough. They may be released only on emergency parole, and that too by the order of the concerned trial court, because they are detained by the court. For other matters, they can be released on bail, which is granted by the court. And the respective state governments, you have all state governments and union territories which may enact a local and a special law or issue instructions for the, and these rules are known as the Temporary Release of Prisoners Act, for releasing them on parole and furlough. Release on parole is not an absolute right, though it is a legal right of every eligible prisoner as per the conditions which are laid down. It's a concession, so it's also subject to cancellation. and restriction of release of a prisoner on regular parole and furlough. There are specifications of various categories of prisoners who are not eligible for release on parole and furlough. That is, prisoners who've been involved in serious offences, assaults, in riots, in dacoity, terrorist crimes, kidnapping for ransom, smuggling of narcotics, and who are also in the opinion of the district magistrate and the district superintendent of police that such prisoners, if they are released on parole, they will not return back to the prison. So no parole or furlough can be granted to convicts also who have been sentenced to death penalty. The Supreme Court of India has been in favour of release of prisoners on parole and furlough in order to ensure their rehabilitation, and the courts have been very generous in granting parole in genuine cases. It's a temporary release of a prisoner for a specified period from the jail so that he meets the family requirements and responsibilities. Some of the general purposes which are mentioned and prescribed under the Temporary Release of Prisoners Act are marriage of the son or himself, marriage of the daughter, the grandson or the brother-sister. And the period is specified. It could be 4 weeks for marriage, it could be 5 weeks for ploughing or agriculture purposes. For admission of dependents, so the child has to be admitted to school, the parent needs to be there. Delivery of the wife for the house repair, once in 3 years only. So before granting parole, the authorities concerned, they seek a report from the police, from the superintendent of police, from the district administration, get a no objection for their release, that this prisoner will report back. Sometimes the district authorities say that no, the prisoner will create a law and order problem. Sometimes normally the criticism is that they give this general report that it will create a law and order problem. And the period for which prisoner remains outside on parole shall not be counted towards the jail sentence. So that means he has not served his time, and the number of days it's been out for, 4 weeks, he will have to spend those additional 4 weeks inside the prison. Furlough means a release of a prisoner for a short period of time after a gap of a certain qualified number of years of incarceration. It's a way of motivating the prisoner to maintain good conduct and also to remain disciplined in the prison. This is an incentive of good conduct. The period spent by a prisoner outside the prison on parole shall be counted towards his sentence. So there is a difference between parole and furlough. It's an incentive for continuous good conduct. And if a prisoner fails to report back from furlough on time, then he is accordingly punished as the punishment prescribed for overstaying for parole. What's the difference between parole and furlough? Now, furlough is an incentive to a good conduct so that the prisoner may establish contact with his family outside the jail for spending some time with them. Parole is a temporary release of a prisoner from jail. Parole is something to help the prisoner fulfill his social obligations, and it's the nature is specified in the jail manual. The second difference between them is a prisoner is eligible for furlough only after he has spent 3 years in jail, whereas parole can be availed by the prisoner after spending 1 year or any other short period as prescribed, whatever is given in the prison manual. And the periods spent outside jail on furlough is counted towards a sentence, whereas for parole it is not counted towards a sentence. The tenure of release on parole is different for different purposes. Now, the judicial trend has been that the release of prisoners on parole and furlough, it has been favoured by the courts in India as a rehabilitative and reformative measure. So what we conclude is that the therapeutic approach entailing the release of prisoners on probation, parole and furlough is becoming popular among the modern penologists. They subscribe to the theory that contact of the prisoner with the outside world has a humanizing effect on him and helps him in the rehabilitation and reintegration with society after release. It will not be out of place to mention that some of the convicts who are released on parole and furlough do misuse this concession and do indulge in crime and social activities. Parole absconders, they are known as, and the police is supposed to follow them up, and they are, after conviction, the ones who have jumped parole or overstayed the period or who have not reported back to the prison, they are given a further sentence. This is the reason that police authorities normally oppose parole applications of even genuine good conduct prisoners. The courts have also been of the view that parole and furlough, they should be granted liberally to the eligible prisoners in the best interest of the society. So it's a reformative mechanism. Thank you.